we go again. I've got an envelope in my hand, and on the back of it, as you can see, it's coming out of Japan. Holy smokes. Even more alarming than that, it's coming from hell. Wow, that is amazing. And as you can see, very specific address, Bob, United States. That's me. So, we're going to open it up. Today's knife is a Case Tony Bowes. This is the back pocket. Very beautiful knife, by the way. Somebody's texting me. All right. Oh, there's this. I don't know exactly what this is, but so far we've got this. And it says, "Hello and thank you again very much for your order. Kind regards, Michael from Hell Guitars." Doesn't sound like a very Japanese name. And then it says, "Order your Super Blacks today at hellparts.com. And what we have here is a pick. It's a black pick. And it seems pretty cool, actually. Just without even really handling it, I can tell it looks cool. Ooh, I like that. You're probably not going to be able to see this, but on the pick, there's like a grippy, and it says Hell in the middle there. And just right away, I can tell that this is a cool pick. I really like this. It's got some like nicely beveled edges, and it's got a little bit of flex to it. It's maybe actually a bit thinner. That's kind of cool. Was not expecting that. Then I have this little magical pouch. We'll see what's in here. I mean, I suspect more picks, but oh yeah, it's a 3-pack. Boom. 3 Hell picks. And yeah, these are let's see, Super Blacks, fast playing, finest sounding, guaranteed to please. And they got these little demons on there, you know. I think that's cool if you're into demons. But these look gnarly. I like these. We're going to open them. But first, a comparison. Dragonheart. And then the Hell picks. This is amazing. I get super excited about this kind of stuff. And kind of started to tear that up a little bit. Sorry about that. And here we go. Looks like a kind of a thicker one. Medium thickness. And then another one of those little kind of thinner dudes. That doesn't bode well. Listen to that. That sounds unimpressive. Let's drop this heavy one. Now this one. Oof. The middle one sounds the best. So, that is the one I will try. Let's lighten this up a little bit. Jeez. They sound okay.
I'll keep you posted. I'll let you know what I think after I use them a little more. These are
Hell Picks.
The Super Blacks. And they are they come with little demons in them. So there is that. For weeks and weeks and weeks, we've been working on a recording, and we finished it a few weeks back, and guess what? This place is not filled with recording gear anymore. It's back to being a rehearsal space. Bam! It's not all gone. As you can see, the SVT rig is still here. Taco Cox seems to be angling to leave it here, which is a bad idea because every time we have a gig, he's going to have to come here and pick it up. And that's just a lot more driving for him. So he'll probably take it home, honestly, soon enough. We are going to have rehearsal this week, rather, for the first time in a long time. And that means that we're going to figure out all the songs that we just recorded and get ready to play them out live. And we're going to have our project mixed and mastered. I'll throw up some footage of rehearsal this week. Right now. Today, I want to talk about guitar cables. It's a highly, it's quite frankly a very boring subject, and I'm going to try to be quick about it. But it is a highly debated subject on forums and the internet, and I think it's important to talk about it because essentially I got into trying to get nice cables because my cables kept breaking. I was using your standard cable that you buy in a guitar shop. I was using those ones that had the cloth covering and I believe they were Horizon brand and they have a lifetime warranty and not a bad cable, but I was really looking for something that was a little more robust, and if it came with better sound quality, that was great. There's a lot of terminology thrown around in cables. You'll see it'll say 99.9% oxygen free, all this different stuff, but my number one concern has always been durability. That is the thing that I wanted the most out of my cables, is that they wouldn't break. So I'm going to go through some different cables real quick and just give you some thoughts about it. But first, I would like to say, I recently picked this up. This is a bullet cable, and I thought they were out of business, but evidently they're back, and the cable looks a little bit different, but it still seems to be very similar to the old style, which, by the way, I have one right here, unopened, bullet cable. I kind of like your old packaging better. That said, the only thing I can really tell, these have shiny ends on them, and these are more of a matte finish. I don't know if that makes a difference, but I'm going to try it out, see how it is. When the bullet cable was going out of business, I bought several, and I've just been hoarding them, I guess. Anyway, good cable, though. Very good cable. Looks cool. If you're into curly cables, a lot of people aren't. The bullet cable is good. It's one of the first ones that came out and was of relative high quality. So, bullet cable. I like those. Next. Okay. There are, when I first started getting into high-end cables, the first one I bought that was really expensive was this monster cable right here. I believe this is called the Studio Pro 1000. Now, they ended up changing this to more of this type of material. This is like a meshy type of material. This is a Divine Noise cable, and it is pretty good. It's a really good cable. I believe these are handmade, or hand assembled, and I believe it's maybe, I'm gonna get this wrong, Oregon probably. I don't know, you have to check on that. But this is a great cable, sounds fantastic. This Rock Pro Studio, I'm sorry, this Studio Pro 1000 cable by Monster sounds terrible. It's a piece, you know what I mean? It's junk. The best cable that I've found, and I've had a lot of different ones. I've had all of the big ones, the Mogami, and I had the LaGrange for a while. That's a great cable, by the way. It got stolen at a gig, and I do plan on getting another one. It's just, it's an expensive cable, and I haven't had a chance to replace it yet. My favorite cable right now, though, is the Lava Cable Ultramafic. These are soldered with real silver solder, I believe, and this cable sounds awesome. And from what I understand, they now make a more flexible one. This one's a little, a little bit more stiff. I use this from the pedal board to the amp.
And this is a great cable, and I think it's about $100, so yeah. Now, this brings me to the guitar, the pedal board to the guitar, and I use this Lava Cable Retro Coil. And it's like a purple, sparkly stuff. It's a super nice cable. These days, cable manufacturers are trying to kind of EQ your sound by controlling capacitance. And one of the things about using a curly cable is it's deceptively longer than it actually seems. So it will roll off some highs. And the size of the cable, you know, I don't know if you guys know this, but back in the day, okay, when us guys in the 80s and 90s were putting our car stereos together, it was a well-known fact that the larger gauge of speaker wire that you used, the more bass response you would get. And I don't know if that really applies to guitar cabling, but it sure does seem like, to a degree, that the size of the cable does bring some, I don't know, I might be putting out misinformation right now, but something to think about. I think that the small size of the coil on these really does help, and it's also more like the original cables that were curly back in the 60s and 50s and 60s. This little cable was in the back of the 1961 Deluxe that I recently got, and it's that small size, and it's, you know, very similar to the Lava Retrocoil. I mean, don't get me wrong, you see pictures of Hendrix and them all the time with this big size right here. It is what it is. That said, when you're buying a cable, try to buy a cable that's well made first. And, you know, if you want to believe the hype about, you know, increased sound quality, that's one thing. Me personally, I've had great results from, you know, buying high-end cables. I feel like it makes a noticeable difference, and they just don't break as much. So I would suggest buying whatever you are comfortable, the best cable that you're comfortable spending the money on.
And one more thing, I don't use solderless cables. I don't do that whole thing anymore. I've had them fail on me too many times. Trust me, it's not that it's hard to put them together. They're not hard to put together. And it's not operator error, you see. What happens is you make these cables, and then guess what? When you go to use them, it's very easy for somebody else to not understand what's going on there and jerk one of those cables. You know, someone, if you have other people handling your gear, like I sometimes do, it's just not a good thing. It's just not. Soldered cables only. Okay, kids? Soldered cables only.
There's tons of awesome brands out there now. And I think it's an endeavor well worth the money. Until next time. Peace.